Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for taking the time on your busy afternoon on a Thursday to come in and get an update from us on what's happening in the central city and a few other things. So firstly, I just want to update you on what the Crown is doing to catalyse a focused and timely recovery. And I want to talk to you a little bit about my view on the central city rebuild and where I think we are at. And also, secondly, as Murray has already said, to hear from you any feedback on how you think things are going in the central city. So when you leave today, what I'd like you to have is a better understanding of the government and that central and local government's commitment to the rebuild, more certainty around the anchor programme, also the approaching changes that Peter Cunningham will talk about around procurement, and he's got some fascinating numbers that will, I think, surprise some of you about literally the volume of work coming forward in the next few years, and also that you'll have an increased confidence for those of you that are landowners to invest in your own projects as part of the rebuild. I have to say at the start that I'm very confident at the moment of where the central city is heading. It's had its ups and downs this year, there's no question about that, but I just want to show you a slide which indicates that this is a building consents in the central city. Down here is week one, so the first week of this year, through to week 30 of this year. What it shows here is a steady growth in the number of building consents being issued in the central city. And that's despite some of the hiccups that the council might have had, which Doug will talk about, that if we draw a line from here, you can see where it's going. And this line, as Peter will show you, will head off up here somewhere and plateau out for some years. So this is a start, but it's certainly a very good signal of where the central city is heading at the moment as far as reconstruction is concerned. The next slide is about commercial property investor confidence. No surprise that down here, not long after the February quake in 2011, investor confidence in Christchurch was fairly low, in fact, well into the negatives. Below New Zealand, but in the ensuing period of time, you'll see that Christchurch has continued to grow and is still trending upwards as far as confidence from commercial property investors. This slide here is about building activity rather than just building consents. This is activity as measured by Stats New Zealand. The blue line is Canterbury, the dotted line is Wellington, and the darker line there is Northland and Central Auckland. This was 2007, and Peter will talk about the numbers. What was the average spend per quarter back in 2007? Those were what we thought were the boom times for the construction industry. This is where Christchurch is today. This is not just CBD, but this is also residential. And obviously it's significantly higher than 2007 and continuing to move upwards. Just got one slide on skirt work. So that's a stronger Christchurch infrastructure rebuild team. This is just a snapshot of the work that I've done since their inception, late 2011. This is around a 5-year program of work with a significant cost attached to it. But this is where it's at now. So 60% of the water supply work has been completed, 30% of wastewater, 45% of stormwater. Roading is only 21%. So we've got a long way to go for those redirects that we get on our way to work. But having said that, roading naturally will always be behind the three waters because underground infrastructure has to be repaired first. This, the land acquisition that we've been involved with the last 12 months, contentious at times, and I know that has been for some of you in this room as well. These are statistics as at 2 weeks ago. We're willing buyer, willing seller, we've just got over 53% of properties under agreement. Now that's, we haven't targeted particularly the innovation precinct, the South Frame or the health precinct at this stage. We have, through our purchases, released $380 million worth of capital back into the market through buying that land and the buildings that were on the land. our key infrastructure our key anchor projects here are those five there. As far as East Frame's concerned, something is on its way to Wellington at the moment saying actually we think we need to compulsory acquire around 10 properties in the north end of the East Frame. Those aren't all because we haven't been able to reach agreements, but in one case there's a company that's been struck off. The only way we can deal with it is through the compulsory path. And so there's one or two like that, and some are we just have not been able to reach an agreement, but it certainly is time for us to move on with the redevelopment in that part of the frame. There's a bit of media earlier on in late June around the agreement between the Crown and the City Council around the cost sharing and lead of some of the anchor projects in the central city. The importance of this agreement can't be underestimated. When the blueprint was launched, it was a visionary document, it was well bought into, but what it didn't have was too much money behind it at that point of view. So earlier this year, we had to get some money through the government budget through Mr. English, and then following that, once we knew what we had, talked to the council about their involvement in replacing, in their case, a number of the assets which are now gone. Just want to touch upon one or two of them. I've got more detail about each project later on, but the frame, for example, so that's the north, the south, and the east frame. There's a cost attached to that of purchase of properties and redevelopment of $481 million. The council's role in this, though, is once the public realm space has been completed, so the cycleways, the green space, and pedestrian pathways and laneways through the various parts of the frames are completed, that land will vest in the council and it's their responsibility to maintain that public space in perpetuity. It was a bit of a surprise to some, I think, that the council has no financial obligations around convention centre. That's something that traditionally the city council has had a role in. The government was very mindful of the council's financial position, and there's been a significant amount of media coverage about that over the last 2 years, really. So part of the reason behind the council having no role in there was the government believes it's critical that a convention centre be in Christchurch, but that the council not necessarily be burdened with that cost at this time or into the future. So that's the reason behind that. Performing arts, that's from our point of view a good decision that the council has actually made a decision around the town hall. What it means is a certainty for us, certainty for the performing arts community. The council still has to provide a home for the symphony orchestra, the music centre and the court theatre, likely be on the south side of Armagh Street. What that means is certainty also for the landowners on the north side of Armagh Street who were designated their properties, and it's likely we will have a look at removing that designation. The three owners here have all got plans that they would like to get underway with that don't involve the Performing Arts Precinct. So a decision at all was fantastic from our point of view. The last one I'll touch upon here is car parking, and I've got some slides on that later on. This is the fifth such meeting we've had this week, as Murray mentioned, and car parking has come out very loudly to us as being a critical part of certainly required for the central city rebuild. So I'll touch upon that later on. Finally, just the numbers down here around horizontal infrastructure. Council's contribution is just over $1.1 billion. The government's is $1.8 billion. So serious amount of money going into that work which Skirt's involved with. So one of our key first up deliveries for an anchor project was the Avon River Precinct. For a number of reasons, firstly, in the consultation the City Council did through its share an idea when they did the draft Central City Recovery Plan, the people of Christchurch said, we really want to see the river being part of our new central city. Also, we see the work being done in there and also the frames as being a place where if you're in the central city and there's a bit of work, construction work going on, you can get out into some nice green space and enjoy the natural environment. So for those that may have had the chance to have a look, we've got one part of it completed by the Antigua boat sheds. So we spent just over $1 million there developing that. You'll see boardwalks if you go and have a look, or if you've been there, you will have seen those. Footpaths going through, a lighting system that will go around the whole river, and an overall renovation of what's happening. We've also narrowed the river there, and you'll see I've got a bit of a fly-through video in a moment. We want to also improve the ecology of the river, so we've narrowed it, we've taken the silt out, so if you go down there you can actually hear the river flowing now. And we've also put in there habitats for eels and fish to improve that ecology. So on the way through we want to work with building owners that have properties adjacent to the Avon River precinct. In fact, we've had Anthony Goff, who's the first one in the retail strip who's underway. His designers have met with our designers to make sure that it's a complementary development, and we're committing that we will have the portion in front of that development of his completed so that we complete that at the same time as he's ready to open. The East Frame is another one of our priority areas, particularly the playground. So the playground, I think, was a surprise to some that we were putting so much focus on a playground in the central city. The advice we had last year was, if you don't have somewhere for young children to go, they actually won't know the central city exists. It's not part of the experience as they grow up. And we need those young children now, they're actually our future generation, they need to be part of the central city in the future. So a big commitment to provide what you'll see on the slide, we say, hopefully one of the best in the world as a family playground. And we're fortunate that we've been able to call it the Margaret Mahey Amazing Place Playground. So now we'll just move on to a bit of a fly-through, just so you can get a better idea of what the river will look like.
In 2011, a magnitude 6.3 earthquake rocked the Canterbury region, devastating Christchurch and closing the heart of the city. The last of the barriers have now come down and the central city has reopened. On July the 30th, 2012, based on over 100,000 submissions from the people of Christchurch, the spatial blueprint and Christchurch Central Recovery Plan was unveiled. The plan identifies the location of 17 anchor projects, key developments with public sector backing that will lead the rebuild and recovery of the central city. The first of these developments to move to concept design is Te Papa o Tākaro, the Avon River Precinct.
This is not just a design job. This is about restoring the heart and soul to our city. This is about restoring the Avon River.
The Avon River Precinct is a key structuring element of the blueprint, connecting the east and south frames to define the core of the city. The 3.2-kilometre riverside park will revitalise the heart of the city and catalyse private sector investment along its banks. The rejuvenated river will create an environment designed to bring people and commerce together. Riverside walkways will pass through retail, leisure and commercial zones, with special areas created to support day and nighttime festivals. The development will also create high-quality recreational green spaces for people to enjoy in the central city. A strong focus on ecology in the design and planning process will ensure that Christchurch will be one of the few cities in the world to boast a healthy urban river that everyone can enjoy.
This is a unique opportunity for design and ecology to work together, to have ecology as a cornerstone of the design process.
We want to restore the river, not just for the river or for us, but for future generations. We want to leave a legacy of a healthy river where our children's children can come and feed the fish, see the kereru, even hear the song of the bellbird, right in the heart of our city.
Important Ngāi Tahu and European heritage is woven into the concept designs for the precinct. In Victoria Square, early settlers traded with local Ngāi Tahu people, and that heritage is celebrated in an area that will become the gateway to the central city, the forecourt of our cultural heart. This resilient green corridor through the heart of the city will provide a unique space for residents and visitors alike. connecting with the East Frame and what promises to be the best all-ages playground in the world. Te Papa o Tākaro, Avon River Precinct. Bringing life back into the heart of our city.
So that's just a bit of an idea for you of what we see the river looking like in a little over a year's time. Convention Centre Precinct, this is a project we went out to the market late last year, and we got a number of respondents to an expression of interest, and we've whittled that down to five. Those five are going to receive a request for proposal next month, seeking the next stage of their input into that. And what we're after here is not just a convention centre box that people do conventioning in, but simply we want a precinct. And we're after at least one hotel, some retail, you might imagine retail along Colombo Street here. Beautiful sites here for food and beverage and nighttime activity. And I would imagine some commercial space above the retail. So that's the sort of thing we're looking at, and we're expecting one of those five consortia to come through as a winner probably around this time next year. It does take some time to go through these processes. This is a big investment we're looking for from one of these consortia, and I'm hopeful that certainly, as I say, this time next year we'll be announcing the winner and they can get on with the redevelopment of that block. Health Precinct is one which has taken us a little bit by surprise, and Sheila will talk about some numbers around that later on. What's happened here, we've established a health leadership group that's made up of some private sector leaders in the health field, along with the Canterbury District Health Board, University of Otago, CPIT, and University of Canterbury. And they've led a process whereby looking at those blocks down by the hospital, what is it that we could have here in Christchurch by way of health precinct. There's been a huge amount of interest in that. The master planning is now being completed. I expect we'll be making some announcements within the next 2 to 3 months about what the vision is, what that combined health leadership group's vision is, and I'd be even more hopeful that we can get an announcement at that time about some private sector investment in that space as well. The bus interchange, so that's where the old council offices were on Churham Street. We've bought a large proportion of the land there. At the moment, we are in the process of completing the detailed brief and the business case. And what we're looking for there is the main construction work starting next year, completion 2015. This is another one of the early ones to get away for a number of reasons, not the least of which are we want to support the public transport network coming back into the central city. Justice and Emergency Precinct. So expressions of interest are out now for the main contractor for this project. This is being led by the Ministry of Justice. You can imagine it's been a reasonable task for them over the last 12 to 18 months to corral all the agencies together that we'd like to see in there. So that work is largely complete. And as you can see there, we're looking for first work to begin on site next year as well. Metro Sports Facility. So the RFP, so request for proposal for this, for design work has gone out. First off, we want to master plan the site, because on the site, originally we'd planned for around 1,000 car parks on grade. The work we've done with the hospital around their redevelopment, also the health precinct, has led to a feeling at this stage that we actually need more car parking there. This is the ideal site for it. So we need to see how do the facilities there, the sports facilities, work in with the car parking requirements. So in here, the vision is for international quality water facilities, as well as community-based water facilities, and also dry side courts for netball, basketball, volleyball, and the like. At the moment, we have planned for 8 courts. Our discussions with some of the netball fraternity are saying, actually, we don't think that's quite enough. 10 or 12 would better suit a national competition. So we're working with the City Council and the various stakeholders to make sure that what is built is appropriate and sustainable moving forward. Innovation Precinct. So this is led by MB, the government department responsible for this particular precinct. They've undertaken a master plan of the area, and I'd expect there'll be some announcements on this in the next 2 to 3 months again around what it is that MB's view of the spatial layout of buildings in this area will be. There's been some initial discussions with landowners that's ongoing around what their involvement might be in providing the infrastructure necessary in this particular precinct. And again, looking for some construction commencing 2014 on that. The retail precinct, this is one which has garnered a lot of media interest in the last 2 years, particularly since the launch of the blueprint and the requirement for outline development plans. So when I look at the retail precinct, some say it's not working, some say it's working too well in parts. What we've got is Anthony Gough underway now, and announcements about that tomorrow again. We move further up the block where some of the government tenancies might appear to have landed. There's some more certainty now around some development in that same block where Anthony Gough is. The Triangle Centre's had its ups and downs, but I'm thinking it might well be on up again now. The Carter Ballantyne Group's got some plans on the southern side where they have land. So the area we've had the most difficulty with, and some of the owners in the room now, is just that southwestern corner, multiple ownership of land and multiple ODPs. So we're continuing to work with those folk. We don't want to come in particularly heavy-handed. We want the private sector to work that out. That was the advice we were given a year ago, was government keep out of there, don't buy up the land and sell it off to a whole bunch of other folk, just let the private sector work that out. So I'm confident that will come to fruition in the end. So the South Frame, there's three blocks in the South Frame. And what we've done there, again, I've mentioned master planning quite a lot. It's a key element of what needs to happen in each of these particular areas of the city in order to give certainty to potential developers, but also the landowners that exist in those areas now. So our approach here has been quite different than other parts of the city where we actually have had an absolute requirement for the properties. Here we're saying, look, we've got a vision about laneways and pathways through those blocks, as identified last year in the blueprint. And we're talking to the owners of the properties we do need to buy and say, actually, we do need to buy this property for the public space. The space in the middle, though, if you're a landowner and you buy into the vision of what we see in the South Frame, we're very happy that those owners continue on with ownership and redevelop if necessary in accordance with the master plans for those particular areas. And where those folk aren't interested, we have bought one or two properties there, but by and large, we're seeing some quite exciting potential developments in those three blocks. Residential development, we were very clear last year that we had bought into the longer term vision that the City Council had around residential occupation and living inside the central city. Their vision is to have more than 20,000 people living in the central city by 2040. We'd like to achieve that considerably earlier. And as far as pushing that along, we identified in the blueprint an area just to the north of Latimer Square, where there'd be an international competition led by the City Council and again MB for anyone who wanted to come along to actually design up and ultimately build their vision of what it is to live in the central city post-quake. So these have been in the media, but these are just the four finalists, and there'll be an announcement around who's won that competition, that right to develop late October. In addition to that, last year we talked about the East Frame as a place where we saw 600 to 800 living units of some description, whether apartments or townhouses inside the East Frame. We're still committed to that, and I'm expecting perhaps just prior to Christmas or just after Christmas we'll have the first available development block in the East Frame for residential development. The other thing we're doing in that space is working with the City Council to look to see what regulatory roadblocks there are between the four avenues things that might be driving land prices up beyond what the residential sector can afford to develop on, or anything else that's a way that's stopping that development in terms of the RMA. The PM announced this front page again this morning in the press today. From our point of view, this is really the government putting its money where its mouth is, bringing 1,700 employees back into the central city, underpinning the redevelopment of four buildings. This is in addition to the Justice and Emergency Precinct, where there's around 1,200 people going to be working once the buildings are complete there. So there's a $90 million cost to this to the government over the next 20 years. As people come in, departments leave old tenancies behind and the lease arrangements behind, and also a lift in the price from what the base price the government was paying before. So from our point of view, and I'd expect most of you in this room, that's a very, very positive statement that the Prime Minister made last week. Another key part of the recovery plan was identified that we actually need to look at what is a transport network inside the central city. We consulted on that earlier this year, and that's in Wellington at the moment. We need a bit of money to get this underway in conjunction with the New Zealand Transport Agency and the Council. You can see there what it talked about. It's exactly what was talked about in the blueprint last year, and a very, very key element of what happens in the central city. All the meetings we've had, as I said, have identified parking, and certainly around parking, as a key element of confidence to those who wish to rebuild in the central city. So what we identified last year was, in broad terms, where these P's are, these are just little blue dots for those in the back, identified where car parking might well locate. And what we're with the council now is working on what's the size of those car parks need to be. There was a thought, and it's still a thought, that actually, rather than having very large car parks right on the street, on the footpath, let's try and get some of the car parks in the middle of blocks to service the whole block rather than just one side, and also take away that really dead space around a car park on the streetscape. So a number of people thought we haven't done a whole lot in the central city as far as getting work underway. A lot of what we've been doing is planning, starting to design some things. So this here is just a list of some of the contractors. Some of you in this room are some of these contractors that are involved with some of the projects. So we are actually spending quite a bit of money in order to get these projects away as quickly as possible. Lastly, this is just a new version of our blueprint map. What it does is just identify, and you've got it, I think, in your handout packs on your seats with a legend, just identifies various areas. The different colours mean who's leading what part of the rebuild, and just shows in a different way as we moved on a year on. The work behind it is now shown on this map.